and Hees songs. Yeah. Tap on my window, knock on my door. I wanna make you feel beautiful. It's a ton of incredible variety at 96.1 BBB. That variety goes a little bit deeper. Just after 3, it's hashtag found. Always dig deeper. Try to find one of the songs you don't hear very often. Today on hashtag found.
That was last time, guys. Colors. Start putting these organic chia seeds. See it there? See it there? What's that with the chia seed? What's that with the chia seed? It's only been like 5 minutes. Already it's all thickening it up. It's like I've been saying, these little chia seeds soak up 10 times their weight. Yeah, oh yeah. That's why a lot of people try to lose weight. Not me. Some people, they want to lose weight. They like chia seeds because they eat them like this. Soaks up 10%. And they feel real full, you know? That's why the little energy bars, you know? Right here, Health Warrior Chia Bar. See how it's just a little dude, but like I said, soaks up 10 times, and then, so might as well be energy bar 10 times that size. Just grab them. It's my energy bar. What are you? With that little power bar, man. Check this out. Well, I gotta eat this, cuz. Yeah. Get them little soldiers in me. Oh yeah, baby. Oh yeah. Usually I wake up. First thing. Superfood smoothie. You know? Truffle, Hollandia. 50 different superfoods. Actually, superfood got chia. But, you know. Oh, obviously, 3 tablespoons that don't have, and 1 little tablespoon of superfood powder, right? How are they gonna do that? Unless, I mean, I don't know, could be, maybe, guys. It could be like that new Matt Damon movie, you know what I'm saying? What's it called? Downsize, you know what I mean? When you go get the, the machine makes him real small, and then he goes into the little universe, and but it's real small. But he gets to enjoy, like, what it's like to be. I didn't even see the movie, but I could see what they talk about. You know why? When I was working on Project Miso, the Marsoc, some plans came across the desk. Yeah, yeah. and it was all about this machine that had somewhere a lagoon, and it made everybody real small. I'm telling you, and that was like 2012. So I think they just busted up that movie downsize, maybe to get us ready. You know, cause like really, it came with that. Well, Honey, I Shrunk the Kids, remember that? Yeah, when he was riding on the little bee. I mean, they first came with that back then. And now, I saw the planes come across. Well, I wasn't supposed to, but, you know, just a little bit curious. And there it was, you know. Gonna shrink us all down and stick us in a place, you know. And it's easier to be like, pluck, pluck, pluck. They just, I mean, that's what they want. They want to be like the old seeing eye and just watch. You know what I'm saying? Put us in a little aquarium and be like, pluck, pluck, until they got us down to 500 million. I mean, think about it. How you gonna take a population from 8 billion to 500 million? I mean, think about the practical aspect of doing that. You know, it sounds all good, yeah. I mean, we're gonna just put this up here on a Georgia Godstones, you know? And then let them be like, hey man, what's up with that? What's up with the 500 million, man? But, really, how you gonna do it, right? Well, think about it. I mean, if they can make one of these machines, which they trying, you know, it's the same thing with CERN, Cernunos, little pussy ass, they trying to make it so they can loose, who? Lucifer and his demonia cohorts, they're trying, I mean that's all they've been doing is trying, but, you know, obviously they haven't succeeded, you know, like I said, maybe, a little demonia got in here and there. I don't know, because sometimes I see on YouTube, someone's like, demon caught live. It's sort of like a 20-second video. And I'm like, what? Let me just, you know, click. And then I see this thing. It's like, I'm like, whoa, dude, that did not look like it was made up, you know what I'm saying? And then, you know, so, I am the last person you want to come at with the whole year gold, well, I'm telling you, but this thing, you know, and like I said, I don't know. You know why I don't know? I wasn't there. I mean, it's really, it comes down to, I mean, it really does come down to that, though, guys, you know? I mean, everyone be like, well, it was this way, it was that way, no it wasn't, it was this way, no it wasn't, it was that way. Jesus didn't have olive skin, Jesus had black skin. Yeah? Well, how you know? Was he there? Nah. And it's also like when they try to tell you what the earth is, middle of the earth is, you know what I'm saying? In the scientism books, so-called science books, growing up, I mean, I don't even know what they told us, you know what I'm saying? It was either the middle of the earth is molten lava, or it is solid, magnetic or something. I mean, really, these jokers really can't make up their mind. I mean, it's almost like, yeah, you're living on a spinning ball. But we're gonna just bring this joker, this black dude, man, what's his name? You know, that guy who thinks he knows everything about physics. You know, he's just an actor. Stupid. Gleekah. And him and that other guy, Bill Nye, who used to be the guy who sold, like, you could get government grants. You could just live off government grants. And he had the question mark suit. Remember him, man? And he's always talking super fast. Bap, 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 bap with his question mark suit. He was just like Enigma from the Batman movie, no? That man with his green question mark suit, man. That's Bill Nye, dude. That's Bill Nye. These jokers, man. You gotta go. Where'd they come from? You know what I mean? They just come on the scene, and they're supposed to be like the science advisors. There's actors, man. It's stupid. Anyway, what I'm saying is, like, they can't make up their mind because that black dude, whoever his name is, y'all trying to tell us now? Oh, nah, man. It ain't no spin ball. I'm telling you. Because, like, around the equator, it elongates, so really, it's the shape of a pear. And I just came across this new guy on Facebook. And he has some great videos that prove we do, in fact, live on a flat earth surrounded by an Antarctica, you know, big 200-300 feet ice wall. I mean, because he's got videos of someone from a look like a helicopter the way it's moving, videotaping, you know, the ice wall. Just following it. It's just going on and on. I mean, and really, all you gotta do, I mean, come on. Go back to the early explorers. You know, I'm saying Captain Cook, of course. Because, you know, he's real well known. I went to Hawaii, Captain Cook, you know what I mean? You know? And then, and Captain Cook got his way down to New Zealand, too, you know, but there was another one. Anyway, they was the first to circumnavigate the flat earth, you know. They didn't go around the ball, they circumnavigated. And I mean, just read their diary. I mean, if you want to, I don't know how many times I should wear a sticker. If you want to know about something, go to its roots. Go to the beginning, you know, and then follow. It's the same thing with the dome firmament. I mean, and how we know they're lying bad on us. And I'll tell you, go to the beginning, follow the timeline. I mean, I ain't gonna bring you all through it, but I'll do it real quick. The main important points is you got World War II. Okay. So, you know, we beat them into submission, the Nazis, just in time too, because von Braun is coming out with his V2 rockets. I mean, I don't even know how. Give him 6 months, he would have dusted the UK. I mean, seriously, the UK would have been like, after a volcano wind, bam, dusted. It's it, that's done, UK is done. It's them V2 rockets. I mean, man, they were large and charged, and they were just going, woo, bam, woo, bam, woo, bam. But, you know, and the facility that the Hitler's cohorts, his deviant cohorts, why I want to use the word deviant? Because I'm the flat earth deviant, y'all. I'm the busta motherfucker. I'm the flat earth busta motherfucker. So, I don't want to call them deviants because that's a good thing to be a deviant, you know what I'm saying? I mean, it's hard for me to trust you, really, unless, I mean, if you went to prep school like me, you know, boarding school, and you didn't get kicked out like me, you know, I got kicked out 2 months before graduation, because they just wanted to tell me, you know, hey man, you made it through all our obstacles, you know, 3 3/4 years since you was just a little freshman, and there was only 20 some of you, and you jumped through all our hurdles, and played the PC game here and there, and guess what? Here it is February. All you gotta do is make it to May. See ya! So, yeah, they sent me packing, but thank the Lord. because if I didn't get sent packing, I would have ended up in my father's alma mater, Indiana University. Man, seriously, thank the Lord, I got kicked out. I had to rethink college, and Indiana was like, well, if you still want to go here, you gotta go to public school and get your diploma, and then read a plaque. I'm like, alright. Went to public school for 2 weeks in South Jersey, and it was all whack. It was so whack compared to prep school, because, I mean, at least at prep school, like, we didn't have class didn't start the same time every day. No, I mean, everybody had a different unique schedule, you know, and one day I might not start class until 11 a.m. I mean, if I had what's called breaks all the way up to 11, then I could just sleep in, you know, I could wake up at like 10:50, you know, and just walk to class, and yeah, a lot of people did that, so, if it was like, well, what about your shower, what about your teeth brushing and all, man, something, telling you, you got to get real stressful prep school, because, you know, I'm not saying it was like academically superior, because it's relative in a lot of ways, you guys. But let's just say, when I went from prep school to public school, Hamilton, New Jersey, for the 2 weeks, it was like I went from senior to sophomore. It was way behind us. And they even stuck me in all the advanced classes in public school. And all the kids, they gave me a test. It's discrete mathematics. That's what it's called. Discrete mathematics. And it was just a normal class for us in prep school. But at the public school, it was like only the most special kids. You know, it's like 10 of them. And I knew them all from like 8th grade, you know, because they was all the nerds, you know what I mean? Yeah, but, I mean, I'm not saying it in a bad way. Nerds is good. They're good for stuff. I mean, I don't understand all this cyber stuff. They do. All the nerds do. Geeks, nerds, whatever. It's all good. John gives everybody specialized talents. You know, cool thing about that is all these geeks and nerds, they're proud now, man. They're proud of who they are, and that's a good thing. Yeah, I mean, like, what's that? Comic-Con? Yeah, they're all like, I'm a geek, I dress up like Buzz Lightyear. Nah, you know what I'm saying. But, except for them furries, man, y'all are some serious weirdos, dude, dressing up like freaking stuffed animals and having sex. And y'all some messed up peoples, man. And I don't mean that in a topsy-turvy way, where it's like, you know, they call you messed up now, it mean that you're really, you know, with it. Nah, you messed up whether it's tops turvy or turvy tops. You just messed up, you furries. Damn. You know, I mean, it's like some people, they don't like, you know, what we call Dungeons and Dragons, I guess. I don't know. But it's not just that. It's like, you know, any kind of like medieval fantasy type scenario, and they go in the woods, they make their own swords with duct tape and whatnot. You know what I'm saying? And one of them is like the sorcerer, you know what I'm saying? He's got the, I don't know, pointy hat maybe, with the stars. That's stupid, right? You know, but a guy thinks he's Gandalf, maybe. And they go run around in the woods, man, and they just pretend like they're wizards and orcs and all that. That's cool, that's fine, man, that's cool. You know, do your thing. That's awesome. Actually, that's awesome. Because Lord of the Rings, New Zealand, man, you know what I'm saying? That's like, that poster right there says New Zealand, Lord of the Rings, because that was filmed, you know, one of the main cities in New Zealand on... is Christchurch. You know, for the North Island, you got Auckland, obviously, you know, where most of the 3 to 4 million people, because that's all there is in New Zealand. I mean, there's more sheep than people. I mean, it's only 3 million. They get to share that most beautiful place on the entire flat Earth. I mean, seriously. I mean, where else are you going to find, you know, oh, I feel like going snowboarding. Okay, there you go. There's a mountain right there. You go snowboarding. And then you're on top of the snowboarding thing, and you're like, oh, you know, I just changed my mind. I think I want to go surf. Down the hill, just right here to the beach, and do a little surf, you know what I mean? Where else are you going to be able to do that? You know, I mean, not probably name a couple places, but not many, but, you know, you might be like, with your surfboard, looking at the waves, and be like, ah, I don't like that, this is choppy, and, you know, whatever them surface is. I just don't, you know, you'd be like, you know what I feel like? I feel like going for a hike in the rainforest, where it's just like a whole bunch of ferns, like that cartoon Fern Gully. I don't know if you've seen that, but Fern Gully, it's like these little elves or something, you know, and they're flying around in this a Fern Gully. Think about it. So they're like, I feel like going down all the way south to Fjordland, which got fjords, you know, that rival Finland. I'm gonna go down Fjordland National Park and just chill with all the fern. With the fern. Yeah, here go 20 minutes. First hockey period is ending. So, you know, yeah. New Zealand got it like that. Got every kind of earth all in one. Got every kind of thing on earth right there in the three islands. Yeah, I said three. In case you haven't been paying attention, you can see one, two. Look close. I mean, if I knew how to zoom, I would. But down there south, you see what that little south is? That Stewart Island. And also known as what? A.K.A. what? Rockyora, yeah, that's right. Future base of ops for the Heaven on Earth project, yo. Build it, and he will come. And that's it, right there. It's one job I want to tell y'all on the flow, and he just told y'all so. Some of you heard, some of you didn't. Those that heard might want to check into that. What's Rockyora? What's Rockyora? Well, I suggest you Google some night sky over Rockyora, night sky over Stewart Island, and just see what come up. Just see what come up. Cause you won't even fathom that the sky could be that beautiful at night. I mean, it's just, and I didn't even know about the Southern Borealis. I didn't even know. When Jah told me, 1995, he's like, yo, man, Hawaii's, it's real nice, I know, because I made it. I should know Hawaii's real nice, one of my best. But these busters, motherfuckers, loaded it up with military installations on me, man. You know what I'm saying? They came, and they took it away from the Hawaiian Kingdom back in the day. They made a lot of promises to the Hawaiian Kingdoms. And they broke them. And now they got all these massive military installations strategically located. Okay? So if you're Putin, or the guy in Iran, or the Chinese guy, and you three are trying to figure out how we're gonna take down, you know, the America, Britain, France, you know, there's that name, you know, but all them countries, you know, get together and fight each other in World War III. Well, Putin's gonna be like, okay, we do this thing like most important, you know what I'm saying? Well, you know, they save strategic locations for when they really need to, obviously. You know, you don't just go into a war and drop your Moab, mother of all bombs, on somebody. You know, you just do a little first with the pawn, with the infantry, then with the, maybe you bust out with the little horse, you know, he go up a little, and then to the right, or to the left, and then if you need to, then you come with the, what that thing called, the bishop, where it go like this, boom, and boom, or the one that go diagonal, bam, or, you know, some people prefer the queen might be like, what a queen be like the Marine Raiders, 2nd Battalion, you know what I'm saying? Air, land, sea, water, don't matter, that's Marines, man, and that's Marine Spec Ops, man, so, you know, that's the queen, go anywhere, but, you know, that's how they do it. But what I'm saying is Hawaii is that place where it's like, if things is in a standstill or something, and they need to just be like, all right, the only way we're gonna win or get past this hump is it take out something real vital to them. What's the most vital thing to them on all this flat earth? Well, yeah, I think y'all can answer that for yourself, right? I mean, what's the most vital piece of property on all this flat earth? You know, in terms of like, where the U.S. has all its most vital military whatnots. Well, that's Hawaii. Yeah, it's Hawaii. You know, specifically Oahu.
Awesome varieties on.
But I mean, if they're gonna throw nukes at Oahu, guess what? I mean, the other islands are not that far, and the nuclear winds just kind of, everybody's just gonna be like, ow, ow! I'm getting all these weird feelings and sores. Yeah, those are called nuclear radiation winds, yo. And it's true, cause I got a couple friends over there, and they don't want to hear it. Why would they want to hear it? They love it there, man. They think it's like, you know, ain't no better place than Hawaii. They don't want to hear that World War III is gonna pop off, and them and their kids is gonna be like, if they stay, you're gonna get all kinds of nasty stuff. Their organs is gonna be melting. I mean, they don't want to hear it. Why would they? I didn't want to hear it, but 1995, that's what John told me. That's what he said, because I kept asking him, you know, where should I, you know, plant where should I plant myself and grow, you know, grow, because I just wanted to start, like, healing centers, you know, because I was in neuroscience, mind-body medicine. I wasn't into the mind-body-soul medicine. I was in mind-body medicine. Now it's mind-body-soul medicine. And I was like, where should I plant my healing center? And I was working with, I was always interested in abnormal psychology. And right near my house on Wilhelmina, top of the Wilhelmina Drive, top of the bridge, there was a halfway house for the mentally ill just below me. Yeah, Jah works in mysterious ways, of course. And there was only one bus going up and down, you know. And there was a little coffee place at the bottom, and that's where we all would wait for the bus. Came once an hour. And, you know, so you get to know, and there was this one Hawaiian, and he was a real big dude, because a lot of, you know, when you take anti-psych drugs like Seroquel, you gain weight. I mean, if he was a skinny little dude like I was, and then you take Seroquel like I did for a while, you could gain 100 pounds in 6 months like I did. And, you know, but I'm grateful for everything, so don't be thinking, oh, man, and, you know, damn, you must be trying to lose it all. Nah, not really. I'm just, if I'm hungry, I eat. I mean, I still love to play lacrosse and bounce on my trampoline, and I'm very active, and, I'll go 5 rounds with any MMA guy any day. I'm telling you, I can go all day if I need to. I think anybody seen my videos can see. I really don't tire. I don't. That's because I don't spaz, you know what I'm saying? I just flow with it. And there's just Jah's unlimited energy, man. And if you let him take your vessel, if you let him take you as a vessel, you don't feel tired. I mean, yeah, I get to the point where I need to take a pokey nap, you know what I mean? It's like 2:30 in the afternoon. I mean, it's not like I went to bed at 10 a.m. and woke up at 2:30 in the afternoon. Nah, I'm always up at like 4 to 6 a.m. I love 4 to 6 a.m. I love 4 to 6 p.m. You know, I just love that time where it's like the transition. I don't know, it's something real nice about that. Anyway, you know, obviously, I started on something, and I'm here now. But that's the way it works, man. I really don't plan, I don't decide. That could be my life motto. Charlie did not plan any of this. Really though, I'm serious. I mean, up until, probably the first time I tried Lucy in the Sky with Diamonds, and then after that, it was like, you know, I didn't plan things out months after that. And of course, you know, after the first Lucy, and then I took Lucy on a second date, and then I took her on a third date, and then I think it was the fourth date where I took Lucy, and I took about 100 of her clones. Yeah, because I was a little bit curious about what that might do to a person's, you know, mind, body, system, you know what I'm saying? And it was real interesting. But that's psychonaut stuff. But yeah, you know, really, I'll tell you why I started this video. You know, that first song, maybe you could rewind, you know, this thing, go back to the beginning. The first song, I didn't know if that was a guy's voice or a girl's voice, but I really liked it. I really liked that song. I don't know who it is, so if anybody knows who that was, let me know, because I want to go listen to more of that girl or boy music. I really like that voice. It's real nice and, you know, beautiful. And that's why I started this, and already we're in a second period. And let's see if there's anything else. 32 minutes. Let's see if there's anything else which I want to tell y'all. Let me just show you guys these right here, okay? These are real cool. And, un momento, por favor. There you go. Now, a long time ago, I was doing the Put on the Whole Armor of God Chronicles. You know what I mean? Because that movie, Frailty, with Bill Paxton and Matthew McConaughey's Frailty. Bill Paxton is like a mechanic, and one day he starts seeing visions, and he's under the car in the engine, and an angel came down and told him, there's humans that are really demons. I mean, they're just really bad people. They got demons on them. Like a lot of humans do. I did. I had demons all on me. But I got saved in the blood of Jesus. And I was just like, well, Jesus was like, and I, the big I and the little I. And you know, that's why when I talk about I and I capitalize the first I and lowercase the second I. Because Jesus is the big I and I'm just the little I. Or, you know, Jah is the big guy, I'm the little guy. You know, that's a good thing, because I don't know, you know, some people are like, well, it's the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. And there's no difference between Jah and Jesus. They just all the same thing, right? You know, and then another person, the Christadelphians. You know, because I looked them up, because that's a pretty fancy name, right? The Christadelphians. Especially me, being from Philadelphia. Who are these Christadelphians? So I checked them out. And what they believe is that it's not the Father, Son, Holy Spirit. They believe that Jah and Jesus is, you know, different in that sense. You know, it's the Father and Son. It's not all just a Trinity per se. I guess that's what the Catholics think. And so a lot of people are like, yeah, well, it's definitely the Trinity. But think about something. When are the Catholics to be trusted ever? I mean, the Pope with his stupid fishman hat. You know, with that big tall hat that he wears? Man, and his people that dress in red, scarlet. When, before Noah's flood, there was a lot of DNA sorcery. You know, they think it's a myth. These bull, half men. You know, no. You think it's a myth? You know, you hear of like a serpent slash man. It's not a myth. The fallen angels, leaded by Sam Hayel or Azazel, when they wanted to have sex with the daughters of men, which made the Nephilims, they didn't have to, because they was watcher angels. They could have just raped them, right? But they talked to the men, and they were like, we're going to teach you all kinds of stuff that could be useful. Just let us have your daughters. It was like a negotiation. They didn't have to. Come on, man. They could just come down and been like, pregnant. You know, they could have. But I guess, you know. But they taught men how to use weapons of war, how to fashion weapons of war. It's all in the Book of Enoch, which I have not read. But I've picked up from people that, you know, have, that I have, am at a point where I can trust. I've seen enough. Like, one YouTuber, his name is Will, and his channel is called The Truth is Stranger Than Fiction. And a couple might be called that, but his is the one with the seashell that goes around like that. And he talks about that design is everywhere. You know, in on the earth and stuff. And his name is Will. So don't get him confused with something else that might be like, truth is stranger than fiction, okay? Be careful. Because if I'm going to tell y'all about somebody, I don't want to tell y'all about some kind of, you know, wolf in sheep's clothing. Because Will ain't no damn wolf in sheep's clothing. Will done taught me a whole lot. A whole lot, you guys. And he a real cool brother. And he a damn good artist. And he got all kinds of talents. I think he's up in the Pacific Northwest. But, you know, I can't confirm nor deny. You know why? I'm on there. Yeah. That's Will. The truth is stranger than fiction. And, you know, if he says something now, I know I can trust what he's saying. At least he looked into it real. He did a real deep dive. And here's what's most important. He is undoubtedly saved in the blood of Jesus. Oh, there is no doubt whatsoever. He's been saved for way longer than me. And I have pointed out, yeah. I mean, God is the general of generals. And any general in a war, he's going to save his most advanced weapon systems for last. Yeah, well, that's Popoki class. That's Philadelphia class, Popoki class. Yeah. But I'm not saying, like, my weapon system of the mind, body, soul is more advanced than Will, because Will got saved, I don't know, a long time ago, because he's telling, like, you know, how he was, you know, serving Jesus way back. I don't know exactly, you know why? I won there. You know, so watch my words, you guys, because sometimes it's easy if I say something like, Jah saved his most advanced weapon systems for last. And Popoke class, Philadelphia class, the most advanced. It don't mean, you guys, that my weapon systems is better than your weapon systems. And when I say the most advanced, I don't mean like it's me and then y'all, because the most advanced could be a whole bunch of us, you know what I'm saying? It's a category, it's not just me. The most advanced could be, you know, who got saved from, you know, I don't know, Y2K till now. It could be a whole bunch of Cypriss or Gleekahs that got saved by Big JC, Coppity Coppy up there. Yeah, you, back there. So watch my words, and if you start getting whiplash, like, what? Just watch that, because you might break your own dang neck. I mean, you might still have fallen angels all on you, and the first thing they want to do is discredit, you know, one of the job from poker class, Philadelphia class. So if I say something, they might just be like, did you hear what he said? Did you hear what he said? He just said he's more important than you. He's more advanced than you. Nah, man, listen. Before we saved, we all have a tendency to self-aggrandize, you know, exaggerate our self-worth. You know, if we're telling somebody a story about something we did, we had a little this and that to self-aggrandize. You know, that's a tendency we all have, because we grew up in a world of, like Bob Barker says, this is a world of competition, rat race, you know, listen to Bob Marley's lyrics, man. It teaches you so much. You know, thank God, because talking about Lucy in the Sky, my second date with Lucy, my first date was in the Hawaii Four Towers for the dorms, the 12-story towers. I lived on the 7th floor. You know, and I knew a kid named Adam Lozier, you know, not loser, Lozier, and he was like on the diamond team, you know what I mean, but he was from Ohio, and he was a white dude, and it's, when you first get to Hawaii, they say it's culture shock. Yeah, it can't be, because all of a sudden, I mean, Hawaii's just really like a lot of Polynesian, Filipino, Chinese, you know what I'm saying? Yeah, it's a couple, because white people, you used to be in the majority, and all of a sudden you're the minority, you know? And then you got some people calling you Hallie. I mean, and you think I had it bad? Man, the way they do black people's there, you know, because I played basketball, and I, you know, not no more. I haven't picked up basketball at least, like, I don't know, 20 years. You know, once I got into MMA and kickbox, you know, basketball, my mom loves Duke basketball. You know, I could hear her all the way across the yard. It's not like we live in a super mansion. I'm just saying, she live on that side of the house, I live on this side of the house. But if Duke basketball is on, because they just made the Sweet 16, I can hear little oohs and ahs. Like me and my brother James, when we watch the Eagles. It's like, bam. I mean, watching the Eagles is like, bam, you got, bam, Nick Foles, hell yeah, get that sucker, tackle his ass. I mean, bam, you know what I'm saying? Any Eagles fans knows what I'm saying. Or anybody that loves watching sports, you know what I mean? I mean, and I'm the same way with UFC, you know? I mean, I did upload a video of me watching the latest UFC when my man Volkov, the Russian, and JAH picked Verdum with his 23-7 record. Now, I told you, 237. Well, I seen when they put the records, and Verdum was 23-7. As soon as my eyes seen that, JAH put it right in my brain. You see that 23-7? That means that's mine. Cause I don't know if you guys seen it or seen my type. I've been betting God my whole life. When I was a little kid, every time I went to the toilet, I did bets with God. I was like, okay, God, I'm sitting there having my little poop or whatever. Yeah, because I'm sitting. You know, I'm like, I bet you, I know the answer of 4 plus 4, and I bet you $10 million. You know? And then I'd be like, it's 8. Bam! Put that on the tab. You know, you owe me like hundreds of millions now. And then I wait like 20 seconds, if that. And I'd be like, I bet you this light's gonna go on in the next 5 seconds. And then I'd be like, flick! Turn the light on because we had a light right next to where the toilet papers was. And I'd be like, bam, that's $20 million. Put it on the tab. I mean, he owes me so much money. I mean, 1995, he gave me New Zealand. I mean, come on, man. You know what I'm saying? He had to pay his debt. It's the big. I mean, you know, when you grow up in all mobbed up, you learn what the big is, man. You know, you learn about loan sharking. I mean, we was loan sharking each other in middle school. You know what I mean? I mean, isn't it? Maybe y'all grew up doing this to that. I mean, I grew up in a town halfway between Atlantic City and Philadelphia. You know, just think about that. 90% Italian and Sicilian. You know, you ever see like in the movies how the top mafia guys, they don't want their kids to go into the mafia. You know, like the soldiers of the mafia, they do. You know, they want their kids to help them. You know, but the top guys, they want their kids to go to college, become a lawyer, a doctor, go into the, like in the Godfather. Michael went into the army, you know what I'm saying? And Marlon Brando didn't want him to be head of the family. He was making Sonny the head of the family, you know? And if you guys think, oh, he think he's Michael Corleone. Nah, that's my little brother James. I'm telling you right now, I'm no way like Michael Corleone was. No. I'm Sonny. I'm the one that got set up and shot at the, you know, when he had the toll booth. I'm Sonny. I'm the one that pop off. I'm the one that if a pedophile can't be fixed, like a Pavlov dog, and I laser tag him from 3 football fields away, if Mrs. Robot, RIT girl, if she find a pedophile and she can track, she can easily track his cell phone where he's going, and I see he's going to a kid's park, well, I go there, and I got my, and where they at? There you go. I'll just show you this. And you know, this is not exactly good practice for the Sun Tzu Art of War. You know, I really don't care. It don't matter. They can try new tactics. I mean, if these damn pedophiles, and they're too worried about kids to worry about changing up tactics, I'm telling you. So, there's my high power laser. Okay, guys, see that? And I'm working on making my own, by the way. And if anybody knows anything about lasers, get at me, because I want to get up to, you know, 3.5 watt to 5 watt. At a big, you know, I want to explore the potential.
Cody started his new information technology career,
you know,
making more money.
These are my,
less
this
hours.
Is all I need.
Hate what you do, don't get boxed
this
in.
This is all I need.
Go to mycomputercareer.edu and take the free career evaluation.
You know, see what a
pedophile's
getting
you
up at if you're going to a kid's park or a kid's school.
That's
all I need.
Live online,
and my staff.
2 or 3 times a week.
You know,
it's not rocket science. Great,
in case I need close quarters combat. And freakers. Oh, yeah. A good song, right? Oh man, that's nuts.
I sailed away to China in a little rowboat to find ya, and you said you had to get your laundry clean. Didn't
be like Hawaiians, yo. Oh, we're gonna do the rest of this standing up, you guys. We get a little stretch. We're gonna finish this thing off on the feet.
Oh no, got to keep on moving.
Try to be like, you know, big Hawaiians, put the kine. I'm like one of them big dudes that just got done eating some kalo and fresh boar from the ground with the rocks and the leaves. Bam! Yeah. But got up because I noticed I ain't got my Roman therapies. See that? I got my Roman therapies going. So I'm just gonna run here. Yeah, all right. So, okay.
96.1 BBB.
Yeah, here's what I was gonna show you. The Put on the Whole Armor of God, that movie Frailty. Bill Paxton, the angel, is like, you gotta get these demons. I'm gonna send you a couple things to help you. There goes the second period of the hockey game. There we go. 52-50. So something, my system ain't doing it every 20 minutes. See? Computers make mistakes. Dumbass iMac. Supposed to do that every 20 minutes. It's 52 minutes. What's wrong with you, man? Slipping up on me. Maybe somebody trying to hack me. Who trying to hack me? Speaking of, got my Mrs. Robot. Looking for Mr. Robot. Anybody? No? So, check these out. Okay, so that movie. I'm gonna send you to you. Oh, I can smell it. It smells good. I'm gonna send you a couple things. It's gonna help you fight these humans that got demons in them. First thing he sent them was a special pair of gloves. Come on. Tell me God did not make these special for pokey class. The kine. Yeah. So, sent Bill Paxton. He was cruising along driving. And you know, he showed him there was a pair of gloves. And they just look like beat up gloves you wear if you're gonna hoe the garden. But he said, you need to wear these gloves. Because, you know, if you go, when you go grab a human with a demon, you gotta be wearing the gloves, because when you take the gloves off and grab them, you'll be able to see all the nastiness they've been getting into. Like one of them that he brought back to his kill room. Wow, I'm getting a little ahead of myself. But anyway, One of them was a pedophile, Freemason pedophile. And as soon as Bill Paxton grabbed King without the gloves, he could see all the kids that the pedophile Busta was taking back to his lair or whatever. You know, and that made it easier because Bill was not supposed to take his gloves off until he had him back. He had a house that was, there was something about it. It was like an old church or something. I'm getting that confused with, you know, Hawaii, that surfer? Go, Eddie, go, or something. Eddie, come on, y'all Hawaiians. Eddie, Kayao, or, you know, and the stickers was like, because what Eddie did was, he was an ocean ambulance, you know, he would save surfers that was drowning. There's a lot of, you know, North Shore 20, 30 foot waves, a lot of people get in trouble. They get sucked under and they run out of air and whatnot. Right, maybe the best surfers sometimes need to be rescued, apparently.
Here's something that's kind of bittersweet.
My
later
brother
fall,
Paul
gonna take Stephen
thought, oh, I could surf Atlantic City waves. I'm going to go to Hawaii, North Shore, and surf them waves. No worries.
And Isaac Newton,
well,
which seems really
his friend, also from South Jersey, Billy Crescenzo, had been surfing Hawaii for a long time, and he was used to it. But he had to save my brother Paul. My brother Paul, first wave he tried, he went under. We came back up, he had no energy left because he was fighting to get back up. Then the ocean started taking him away. And he knew he was in trouble. He started panicking. You don't want to do that. Oh, no, no. If you get in trouble, no matter what, they don't panic. Running out of air, someone buries you underground. I just saw a movie with Adrian Brody. You know that Jew with the big nose? I like his acting style. You know, Piano Man, or he played the piano, he played the Holocaust Jew, hide in the attic, he played the piano, you know, Adrian Brody. This is when he was real young, like 1999, and he played a guy who thought he was Harry Houdini, a skate artist, and he kidnapped a real rich lady, and told the husband where to bring the $1 million ransom to Harry Houdini's grave in New York City. And of course, the cops was waiting. And when he went to pick up the money, he left with his muscle car. This one female cop grabbed him up, brought him back to the police station. And then he was like, I'm only gonna talk to you. You gotta turn off the camera and shut the two-way mirror. And when they did that, you know, he was escaping Harry Houdini. So he took all his cuffs off. He had a little wire stuck under his... They do that a lot, right? They stick stuff under the fingernail. And then, I mean, why don't you just tape a handcuff key, you know, to your butt cheek? Just duct tape it to your butt cheek. But, you know, movies, they try to put something sensational or whatever, something unique. So he pulled this wire out his fingernail and undid his cuffs and his leg cuffs. And then she, as soon as she figured out, you wanted to be here. You know what I'm saying? Because he had already been there before as a pretend painter and made an escape route. And as soon as she figured out, because he kept hinting at her, you know, what his intentions were, finally the light bulb goes off. And she's like, as soon as she made that look on her face of acknowledgement, he just went, he did with the smile. Because he smiled a lot in this movie. He had this, like, cocky smile. It's kind of cool, too, because he had braces, you know what I'm saying? And the first time, actually, that was real cool. The first time he had to escape from the cuffs, he took the wire out from his braces.
The 96.1 BBB,
anybody
awesome
said I had braces
awesome tonight.
Grade
8,
the sophomore year.
On the show every night.
Can't you just tell how beautiful
teen stars
look at them things, nice
days
and white.
Yeah,
for a
spot
time stay, can't tell. But, yeah, so the first time he escaped from the cuffs, he took the wire out of his braces and did it. And I thought like that, that was real unique. And, so I mean, that could be like a backup. I mean, if you're really worried, go into a situation, potential situation, maybe put fake braces with the wire. I don't know. In fact, there's this site called mudcake.com. I bought a lot of these, you know, walking sticks slash swords. You can see the black things over there? They're like, you know, Khonshu walking sticks slash spike, stuff like that. You know, before I found Brazos exotic wood walking sticks, you know, I bought a couple of them. They're not practical. You know, anyway. Yeah. So, but yeah, what I was saying was they got a couple things. It's like lock picking. How to teach you how to pick a lock. It's like they give you a lock, and instead of metal, you can see through inside to the little levers and gaps. And they give you a lock picking set. That way you can watch what happens when you just manipulate it. I'm gonna get one, you know what I mean? It's only like, they had one that was $30, and it was only like 10, but, I mean, I guess full disclosure, I only got like $11 left until the 1st, so, you know, can't be spending 10 of my last $11 on a dang how to pick a lock. You know, that's like emergency, you know, like, I think Netflix charges me like the 28th of each month, and that's like $10.99, so I really, that's for that. Yeah, that's for that. And I got a week free of UFC Fight Pass, UFC TV, and I think that week actually runs out before the 1st, so they're probably going to have to cancel me, and then I'm going to have to start again. That's no worries, you know. It's no big deal. They cancel. You just start when you can. All right. So I can see myself looking over here. So, yeah, I want me to jump back into this. I think it's important. It's real important. So, like I said, Mrs. Robot, she can find the pedophiles around here. She can tell where they all go, and if they go into kids' schools or kids' parks, why is a dang pedophile going to kids' park? You're not supposed to. But his probation officer, if he'd been caught, he's not been paying attention, obviously. Well, I'm paying attention. Mrs. Robot's paying attention. You don't think you can get away with stuff? And if me and her's not paying attention, you know who's always paying attention? Always? 24-7? Yipper. Almighty. Up above. I mean, y'all think you can get around the laws of man and some of God's earth soldiers? Gonna get judged eventually. Y'all don't believe God. Y'all? Anyway, yeah, okay, keep looking at it. So this is all. It's all I bring. Binocular and laser. And this is only a 5 milliwatt laser. I wanna get into what's the possibility of a 3.5 watt or a 5 watt. I want, you know, not just pop balloons, but, you know, put holes in fall out turkeys. You know what I'm saying?
Your music.
Yeah. But before you do them like that, before you give them a long distance lobotomy, frontal lobe lesions, that's your last option if you can't fix them. First, you try to fix them. That's how I do it. And I don't do jail. I don't do lock them behind bars. That's stupid. So, they don't learn nothing. You can lock a pedophile up. If he, He ain't the kind that's gonna get fixed. Lock him up for 30 years, he's gonna come out. The first thing he's gonna do is go look for a little kid. Hey, I said 30 years. I knew it when I did my 21 days in a Florida Pinellas County jail. I was trying to get it in my Toyota Camry. Because after 21 days, the storage fees was over $1,000. I came out of there, I didn't have nothing. You know what I mean? All the money I did have went to like long sleeve shirts because it's so dang cold in jail. It's like a refrigerator. It's germs and spread and all that. It's cold. I had like two long johns on. Anyway, and that was Florida. Probably had something to do with no sun for 21 days too. I mean, when I first got out after 21 days, I couldn't even. The sun was killing my eyes. What I'm saying is, you lock these pedophiles up, and they're not the type that's gonna get fixed. You know? Then what you gonna do with them, man? Comment on it. What you gonna do with them? I mean, you gonna like fly them to an island? Yeah, that's not a bad idea, but what's the pragmatic aspect of that? So, you know, I'm thinking, you know, I know a little bit about neuroscience. I'm thinking long distance lobotomies, you know, little frontal lobe lesion. But before that, try to fix them. So, you know, classical conditioning, aka Pavlov's dog, you know, try to teach them. So, if I'm watching, you know, and they start with the whole, you can see, so they start getting excited. They see one they like, because they picky. They see one they want. These are our kids. Maybe they start licking them chops. I hate to make it sound nasty, but that's what they do, and this is my job. This is what Jah has me up to. I mean, yeah, the Heaven on Earth project, we get into it all. But personally, you're not gonna just send anybody out there to do long distance laser treatments on pedophiles. Come on, you gotta have a little bit of specialization. A little bit, you know, this and that. A little bit no fear at all. But Pavlov's dog is basically, if I see him licking them lips or getting excited, because you can tell, just go, bam, right in the eyeball. And they'd be like, ow, ow. You know what I mean?
Whatever you
anybody
do
who's ever been in the classroom and they had their watch, make the sun go into one of their friend's eyes or their teacher's eyes, they'd be like, ah, ah. You know what I'm saying? Just think about that in your eyeball. It don't feel good. I just accidentally got myself through sunglasses and I hurt like a mother. So yeah, you do them. And they're like, ow. And it brings their attention away from your kids. And then of course, that's the first one. They're gonna come back again. After they're like, what was that? And then they come back again, and as soon as you wanna get them right when they're about to make that thought connection with the kid. Just watch Clockwork Orange, man. You know, that's it, right? I mean, you want to talk about reprogramming and whatnot. That's it right there. That's not just a movie. That's Stanley Cooper. Stanley Cooper was all about telling us how they really do it. Of course, I know. I was in them labs with the Clockwork Orange, keeping the eyeballs nice and moist. So, that was my job. When you first start your job, you get the, I don't want to say shit jobs, because it wasn't, I loved all of it, but yeah, somebody got to do it with the eyedropper, unless you got a fancy machine that does the eyedroppers for you, but you got to keep the eyeballs moist. If you can't blink, your eyeballs is going to dry out. That's obvious, I hope. Anyway, as soon as you see them, and you try to get them with that thought, connects with the kid, and then you go, bam, you hit him right in the eye again. Because these lower power lasers, if if I hit him anywhere except the eyeball, they're really not gonna feel it. You know, maybe with a higher power, 1 watt or 3.5 watt, maybe if I keep it on somewhere, like the arm, for a couple seconds, you'd be like, ah, dang, I don't know, I haven't. This is only 5 milliwatts. It looks real bad, I know. That's just the casing. It's just a little diode and a 18650 battery. So, let me just say something real quick. Remember when, back in the summer, when it was like, North Korea might hit us with a nuclear weapon, and we don't know if we have the ability to shoot the nuclear weapon out of the sky before it hits the West Coast. You know, first we're like, they'll be able to hit Hawaii, then we don't know if they can hit the West Coast. Oh, but a month later, now they can hit all the way to Chicago, and then a month later, oh, they can hit anywhere in the U.S. You know, they just ain't gonna throw it at you all at once. You shot the hell out of it. It's like boiling a frog. You know that a frog, if you stick a frog in a pot of water, put it on the stove, and slowly raise the temperature, he, when it gets to the boiling, he will not jump out. He won't notice because it was a slow, you know what I'm saying, process. But if you boil a pot of water and then stick a frog in the boiling water, he's gonna jump right out. You know what I'm saying? Well, that's how any scientist would know his thing though about that. I mean, so the NWO scientists know they can't just stick us in a pot of boiling water because we're just gonna jump out. But if they slow boil us, get us used to stuff little, put it in movies, make suggestions, put it in the music, and all of it. Yeah, well, it looked like they're taking the grand old time. Like I said, 1988, Rothschild's in his magazine, The Economist, was like, well, we're going to bring this NWO New World Order to fruition, per se, by the year 2018.
Moving along. That was 1988. That's 30 years ago. No problems either in the works on that 40 either eastbound or westbound, continuing on 40 eastbound into Johnson County. That's rolling along just fine at this time. Visit Johnson Hyundai of Kirby during the season of more sales event and get the best service, the lowest pricing, and the largest selection, including the 2018 Elantra. That's why Johnson Hyundai is North Carolina's number 100 dealer right here in the Cary Auto Mall or at johnsonhyundai.com. I'm Mike Riddle, 961 BBB traffic.
Was it Woodrow Wilson or Herbert Hoover? I get them guys mixed up. Like we did a whole hockey game, guys. And really, it's funny because I just wanted to see who had that beautiful voice. An hour 13. And now look, I did a whole hour. And, you know what I'm saying? Did it start with the Federal Reserve and the money lending fractional interest scheme? You know. I don't know. I wasn't there. But, I'm just thinking because one of them bankers, J.M., somebody help me out. One of the bankers was the one who was funding Tesla. You know, like the best scientist ever that wanted to help bring about free energy and knew a whole lot about the way electromagnetism and a lot of stuff worked. Not everything. You know, he might have not been alert as to possibly that there was a dome. I mean, that was before. I was going to do the timeline for you real quick. After World War III and the Nazis, and we got to them before their V2 rockets and all that. But some of the Nazis escaped on submarines, you know, to Argentina. And then, of course, Argentina to Antarctica. Some will say, well, you know, they got together with all these super races. I didn't know about none of that. I wasn't there. But what I do know is Antarctica does surround the flat Earth. It's where the dome firmament meets the ground all around us. And that's why they don't let us go there. Because Admiral Byrd did a couple couple different expeditions. His first one, he came back and reported what he's seen, this big ice wall. Then he got in his airplane, went again. Then he got it so that he had his airplane's fuel mixture so he could go further because it's real cold. They had to have a certain fuel mixture. Then after he came back, he was like, yo, you don't even understand what I saw. And he told him, it was obviously, he saw where the dome firmament met the flat earth. Because as soon as he reported back that time, soon after, using high altitude nuclear weapons, it was a moratorium. They went Russian. They said, we're not going to do it. But Admiral Byrd comes back and reports something, right? And all of a sudden, the U.S. start up with Operation Fishbowl. Come on, man. Come on. Fish, upside down fishbowl. Then Operation Dominic. Go break down the word Dominic. You know, and what was the, what kind of nuclear weapons, missiles did they use? Thor class. And what was Thor, the Nordic god of? He had the big hammer. And, you know, so it was like, with the hammer on the dome, you know what I'm saying? Yeah. And, I don't know exactly what they're thinking when they're making up these names, but they make it pretty damn obvious. When Admiral Byrd's expedition is named Operation High Jump, and over the ice wall, and then Operation Fishbowl, high altitude nukes, the highest one they blasted was 400 kilometers. And I was thinking, oh, well, the dome must be around a little higher than 400 kilometers. Because if I was a scientist and I wanted to see how high the dome was, I would blast one off. You know, the highest one I blast off would be, I would know that's where it is. I can't go no higher, right? That's how you think. Especially if you're not worried about cracking the dome. And they weren't. They probably were thinking, man, let's just bust through that thing and see what's on the other side, right? Because that's what they're doing in CERN. They're like, man, let's just open up this portal to another dimension and just take a little peeksy and see what's out there. Well, some of them are like that. The lesser evil, the more evil know what's on the other side. And that's the demons. Lucifer, Satan, the demonians. God has them locked down in another dimension. Like I was saying, maybe some of them get through. You know? You know, with that, what was that little girl, that movie, that TV show on Netflix, Stranger Things, you know, that was from a real experiment in an installation that's actually somewhat still standing on Long Island, Montauk. Man, Josh's going into all kinds of stuff. You know what, I'm getting a little bit...
96.1 BBB.
Getting a little bit,
There is plenty of sports arenas around here. There is different college basketball, football, baseball.
I wake up, guys, before I have any kind of fuel, you know? A little bit cold and stuff.
Gotta
get my fuel. Like I said, I usually go for my super food sleep, but I wanted to see how the chia seeds do. They do good in case you have the cold. Hell, got plenty of energy. Anyway, I like
your music.
I like the way you're down.
96.1 BBB.
It's nice. Anyway. So, let me just get this fan. Does anybody else keep their fan blowing on them 24 hours a day? When I bought this fan 2 years ago, the reason I bought that one is because it was known for just going and going and going. I have not turned this fan off for 2 years, you guys. It's like, you see these blinking lights? Really, it's got me like, wow, for sure, which I wanted to be. The reason I did the blinking lights, I wanted to explore the potential of light therapy, which is a thing. And actually, it was still when I was with Transcendental Meditation. One of them, Transcendental Meditation guys, is a psychiatrist. And he did a lot of light therapy, but it wasn't colored lights. And sure as hell wasn't blinking colored lights. But I just thought, alright, well, if one type of light is good for you, how about all the colors of the spectrum? You know what I mean? And who doesn't like sitting in a room with Christmas lights? Something feels good about it. And then, I got these because I thought you could shut off the blink, but you can't, they just blink. Bought them 2 years ago, guys. Had them plugged in 99.9% of the time, and they still be blinking. Isn't that nuts? I mean, I bought a strand of Christmas lights and put them, that's a walk-in type of closet, you know? Used to have a little sink and stuff. Mom took it out. But I put some Christmas lights, regular little ones. Those are like ball-shaped, but I put the regular ones. They stopped blinking after 3 weeks. And these suckers been gone 2 years. Somebody explain that. Well, I just think, you know, God works in mysterious ways. You know, it's like when I was in exploring Puna near the volcano on the Big Island. You know, and I don't know what, it may have been like my ninth date with Lucy. It was New Year's, and they was passing around a jug of wine, and I had a date with Lucy. Now that wine was real special, and it was a great date too, because it lasted for a long time. I mean, yeah, and I just remember I ended up with some locals, and we were in the car and we were exploring, and the gas tank was on E, and somebody was like, "Do we need to get gas?" And somebody else was like, "We don't need gas. This car don't run on gas. It runs on God." And I will never forget that. I was like, "What? Seriously? Is that possible?" You know, I think these Christmas lights don't run on electricity. I think they run on Jah. But could be wrong. Because, you know why? I ain't up there. I can't confirm nor deny. Okay, here we go. I keep getting away from it. So, Pavlov's dog, classical conditioning, or is it operant conditioning? There's operant and classical, and they're basically the same, a little bit different.
BBB.
Pavlov's dog was, this Russian guy Pavlov taught his dog something to do with saliva, and he can make his dog salivate if he, with the sound of a bell, because he would shock the dog or something. But look it up. But he taught his dog, basically. Yeah, when his dog did a certain thing, he shocked him, let's just say. He shocked him. So the dog was like, what? He started associating the shock with the action. And then, Pavlov took away the shock, and he associated ringing the bell with the action. So he didn't need the shock no more. He just rang the bell, and the dog started salivating. I might have messed that up. That was like Psychology 101, 1993. You know. But that's the concept. I mean, these pedophiles, they start doing stupid stuff. Bam. Right to the eyeball, and they're like, ow, and they associate that owie with the bad behavior. And then maybe it takes three pops. 4, 5, 6, 7. Hopefully they're gonna get it. And it don't, you can do it all in one session. Maybe they come back and you do them again. Keep trying to fix them. But there are those that won't be fixed. Like I said, be in jail for 30 years and come out. Because, yeah, I was telling you, in Florida, I had a roommate, a cellmate, and he kept saying he had been in there for 6 months. And all he talked about was, the first thing I'm gonna do when I get out is buy the biggest crack rock and smoke it. He said, I'm gonna do that before I even eat. So, he's the crack addict. Obviously, he ain't gonna be fixed in 6 months. I mean, maybe later in his life he got fixed, right then and there. After 6 months, all he wanted to do was smoke a dang crack rock. So that's my point. Some people, they just, their neuron system associating with certain behaviors, it's so locked down. In terms of our personality, they use the word indoctrinated, brainwashed. But in terms of brain, neuron building, and that's just established networks of neurons. It's so established, it's hard to break them. And one of the best ways to break up a established neuron, we're talking a lot about Lucy, Truffle, Glandia, you know? They can break down that neuron, you know, structures and pathways, and, you know, anyway. Just another little session. And like I said, I just really, I mean, you saw I started this thing, I was still getting my first meal, and I do that 5 minutes after. As soon as I take my piss, I go to the fridge and it's either superfood smoothie or like chia seeds. You know what chia seeds are, you guys? Remember the chia pet? The little thing, the kit, and then the afro grows out of the little clay, and they call it the chia afro. That's chia seeds, yeah. And it's one of the best superfoods, I'll tell you, I'll give you energy, just it's nice. But, I was telling you about that. Put on the whole armor of God. You could say, one of my first vlogs was about, you know, in the Bible, put on the whole armor of God, a lot of those challenge coins, and they talk about the helmet, the breastplate, the sandals. You know, the shield. Well, I was doing my version because I don't wear a helmet. You know, I wear a hat. My preference is your regular old hat. And, you know, gloves. Because like I was saying, Bill Paxton had to wear the gloves when he grabbed the demon so he didn't get all entranced with bad things, the evil stuff there. Like, I told you about the pedophile, there was a woman, and she was beautiful. She was, like, so smoky on the outside. But the angel said he put her name on the list. And when Bill Paxton and his two kids being grabbed up, this woman brought her to the kill room. He might have been, I might be making this up in my head, because I wouldn't be. I might be a little kind of confused, like, yeah, but she looked real good. How could she be a demon? Well, as soon as he took his gloves off and grabbed her, he could see what she really looked like. Her true face on the inside. She was a mangled up, ugly demon. Like the ones I see on YouTube, where it's like a real demon spotted on video. She looked all messed up. No. So, you know, you guys know some of the most beautiful females and males on the earth look great. I mean, a lot of females would be like, Johnny Depp, he's so beautiful. Man, that is one serious satanic, demonic fool right there. Look what he did with the Memphis 3. Man, that's some satanic busters right there. And he went in with all his money and influences and got him out of jail. And now him and the main guy that had the long black hair, man, all you gotta do is look at their tattoos. Come on, man. They were talking like, we're not satanic. Just because they cut their hair and wear a suit, I don't know, whatever they do. Look at their tattoos. Look how they mark up themselves. It's all satanic occult symbols. They're satanic as hell, man. Come on, man. And they try to blame it on some Christian father, you know what I'm saying? That's how they do it. Try to take the blame away from a Satanist. Blame it on a damn Christian guy who lost his kid to them Satanists, man. Memphis 3, man. Aw, oh, man. Yeah. Some girls might be like, oh, Johnny Depp, he's so fine. Man, he just... If you had special demon gloves,
hey, it's John at 96,
and you got to see Johnny Depp's true, the way he really looked,
good news that
man, he looked
today?
Like a monster. Boy, and you girls would be like, oh my God, oh Lord, I had no idea. Well, I'm guilty of the same thing.
They're coming to town.
Sometimes, you know, I'll see a girl, and she's so beautiful on the outside. I just go get to know her if I had enough guts at the time. And she'd be like, spoiled, you know, like Ryan, talking about people like they're less than her, you know, just ugly on the inside. Yeah, so be careful, I mean, you know, don't judge a book by its cover and all that stuff. Yeah. So, we covered a few topics, you know what I'm saying, and we went into how I pretty much spend my days. I mean, Mrs. Robot, she finds these freaky deaky Freemason pedophiles around here, around, you know, and she could tell no words where the cell phone, man, she could just track them. And then, you know, I go with my binocular and my laser and I try to fix them. And I'm exploring that right now, the potential. And, if any of y'all know anything about building lasers, diodes, please get it. There's the potential that I think, you know, anybody's like, leave them poor pedophiles alone. Man, what's that whiplash? I'm trying to help them. I mean, would you rather I just go up with a big Shinwa hand-forged sword? Like that girl, the dread in Walking Dead, and just slash the top of their brain off? I'm trying to help them with the Pavlonian. I know you can agree with me, you don't want these people going to your kids' schools and parks salivating and, you know, I hate to get, make a bad image in your head, but they start with the touchy-touchy, the hide behind a tree, per se. I mean, Kevin Bacon was in that movie, you know what I'm saying? And he's not usually in movies like that, but he played a pedophile who had to go to jail. He got out of jail, and his probation officer was all up in his stuff, you know, about watching him, because he knew he was going to relapse. And Kevin Bacon got a girlfriend, you know, can't remember her name, but I was really surprised when she got naked in that movie. Man, she got some real nice titties, you guys. What's her name? Karen Sedgwick? Maybe. But I was really surprised. Sometimes you see females in movies, you know what I'm saying? They don't look like they built real nice. Then they take their clothes off and you're like, damn, that's like that Karen Sedgwick or something. That movie with Kevin Bacon played the pedophile. Go check it out, man. She take her clothes off because they had sex. Because it was hard for Kevin Bacon to have sex. Because he wanted the little girls, you know what I mean? But she was trying to help him. And she took her clothes off and her titties was real nuts. Real nuts. I know. Anyway. So Kevin Bacon saw a girl. They're picky. And he saw a girl that he liked. This girl was in the movie with Leslie Snipes when she lived with her grandma and he was on a special mission and he had to go into hiding and he hid like in an abandoned apartment near her and her grandma and she used to come in, she was real curious, do you need help and this, and she would run errands for Wesley Snipes, that girl. You know? And I think she was a real promising young actress. I haven't seen her, or maybe I don't recognize her, because she was only like... When she was with the Kevin Bacon, she played like a 12 to 14-year-old. And then with the Wesley Snipes, again, with the 14-year-old. And I was like, she's real promising, that girl. Watch for her. But I don't know. I don't know where she's at. Anyway, Kevin Bacon followed her to a... a park, you know, because they wait to get the kid where nobody can see. And I don't know if she was bird watching or feeding birds. She was in a park, and Kevin Bacon sat down next to her. And he was real experienced about not coming at these kids too strong, because they get good at it, these pedophiles. And he waited for her to pick up on that he wasn't a normal man. And then, apparently, she knew men like him. She had experience with men like him. And she said, "Do you want me to sit on your lap? Okay." And then Kevin Bacon said, "Do you want to sit on my lap? Okay. So if you Peter Freakers ever find yourself in that situation, once you say, 'Do you want to sit on my lap?' that's a line you don't cross, in case you don't know that. I mean, because some of y'all are real confused. I know you're confused. That's a line you do not cross. And that's when you get shot with the laser. Because it's all right if you want to sit next to the kid. If you're both bird watching and it's a little kid. I mean, I'm not saying grown men can't. You know, we've got fathers and kids, man. And their father's friends can interact with their kids' daughters. I'm not saying we're going to be in a world where we can't do that. But there's lines. And you should know those lines. Jah will tell you. You should, I hope, unless you've got a deranged something or other. It's derangement syndrome. But, you know, that's a sign. If I'm in the park watching these two, and I can read, if I had a lip reader, I can't read lips. If I had a lip reader and it was like, you know, like a sniper and he's got his spotter, if my spotter was like, he just said, "Do you want to sit on my lap?" I'd be like, "Where's my laser?" I'd be like, this is exactly, I'd be watching like this, right? And this is how it is. I keep it right here. You know, and maybe I'll look at taping it onto my head or something, you know, like a cyborg with the laser. But anyway, this is how I do it. You know? And as soon as that line gets crossed, that side of the licky lip and the feely feely, bam. That's it, right there, bam, and then you wait. As soon as they do it again, bam, bam. And you do it as many times as it takes. And then you'll get to a point like the people with the high-altitude nuclear weapons. After hundreds of high-altitude nukes, oh yeah, I was saying, I thought that the dome was 400 kilometers, but then somebody corrected me, and they said, "Nah, read carefully, because they actually sent 4-class nuclear..." Oh, there it go. There's something about you that makes me sweat. Hour 38, boy, that's a long one. So, it's almost 2 overtime periods, you know what I'm saying? And, I could see the crowd getting restless. I think there might be a bench clearing and the whole stadium. I think it might be a big brawl, you guys, so I better get quick with this. So what I'm saying is, the scientists, they sent one way above 400 kilometers, and it came back down, and then they blasted it. Because they could blast it at the height they want. That's the highest blast, 400 kilometers. They sent them higher. So who knows how high the dome is. I wasn't there. And like I said, you know, I think I made my point clear about how to fix a pedophile, and if you can't fix them, like the scientists knew, we don't need to test no more nukes. We know, we mapped the whole dome. If we do any more, it's just waste. It's a waste, and the bean counters are probably like, every time you shoot a nuclear weapon, it costs $100 million or $6 million. This is back in the 50s, late 50s. It costs $6 million, whatever. So, you know. Scientists were probably like, "No, let's blast up thousands of them. Let's try to break through the dome." You know what I'm saying? Like a big Nephilim in Antarctica trying to bust through the dome. You know, like, Maybe that's where they got the whole Thor legend from. It was from a Nephilim pounding on the dome. Boom, boom, trying to break it. Well, you ain't gotta break God's impregnable dome. The only thing that's gonna break the dome is God. You know, when he sent down, I don't know, I wasn't there, but some say that the Milky Way was cracking the dome.
Incredible variety.
Yeah, because some crystals, some crystalline crystals will heal themselves. You put a crack in them, it will heal itself. So maybe the dome is a big, like, crystal, glass-like crystal, and God put a big Milky Way crack, flood waters, because it's waters above, waters below. Waters came down from above. You know, the flood just came on. Springs from deep down. Water from above and not just rain. Maybe God cracked the dome and water came down. It's a theory. I wasn't there. But it makes sense, right? And the Milky Way does look like a big old crack. And maybe it healed itself. Because that's God's that's super crystal. That's God's. Some say they found pieces of the dome. That's another support for that theory. Sahara Desert, they found little bluish. Because the sky blue. Well, that's the dome, maybe. They found little pieces of the crystal, they brought it back, and it was not like anything on Earth. They did studies on it. And it's bluish, it's impregnable, they can't burn it, no matter how hot temperatures they throw at it. It's impregnable, it's unbustable. That's the dome. That's why a Nephilim, even a 4,500 foot high, like the Book of Enoch says, 4,500 feet high. So all y'all with the special forces found a 15-foot tall, red-headed, dreaded up, smelly Nephilim, and he got one of the special forces on a spike, because the machine guns wouldn't even take the Nephilim down at first. They say he's only 15 feet high, and he was super strong, right? Well, yeah, maybe. Nephilims come in all shapes and sizes. Maybe. You know, I don't know how tall Goliath was. I wasn't there. But we do see things come in all shapes and sizes, so I can see that, yeah. I don't know why special forces might have been lying, but some, just because the special forces, and they're the best of the best, you know, JFK established them in case the deep state got too, you know, with the martial law and the, you know what I'm saying? So, that's why special forces got organized by JFK, and then they did him, they slept him. And, so yeah, but in the Book of Enoch, Enoch clearly states how tall the Nephilim was. And he don't use feet. He uses some form of measurement back in the day. But, just due to, you know, the math, translation, is 4,500 feet. And some people, they just could not fathom that. You know what I'm saying? So they was like, oh, it must be an error. It's really only 450 feet. Nah, man, it's 4,500 feet. Because on YouTube, there's a dude named Roger. Mud Fossil University. Because what he'll teach you is like, you know, like in Colorado, they got the red rocks and a lot of red, looks like red dirt. And that's just dried up Nephilim blood, man. Oh, yeah. Go look into it. Because when God sent the flood to take out all these Nephilims and beast men and snake men and the Pope, the hat, I forgot to tell you, that's from the fish man they worship. The fishman. The hat shaped like a fish head. Because they was really just worshiping that fish person. You know, that whole thing about the fish in the sea is going to give you any wish you want, all the gold in the world. Yeah, well, those fables are all. They're not just fables and myths. You know, that's all from real history. Yeah. And, so yeah, the Pope with his fish hat. The Sphinx was a DNA sorcery Nephilim giant, you know, and it looks like it was carved. Man, it wasn't carved. When God sent the flood and the waters from deep, it took these giants so fast It's like when a volcanic wind, I was talking about that earlier, it just spreads 500 miles an hour or super fast and turns people into, you know, whatever they were doing, you know? Well, that's the same thing when the giants, the Nephilim, the waters came so fast, the mud and the water, it caught the giants and they couldn't move. And that's why it's called mud fossils, because the giants is the same as us, the flesh, the blood, they just bigger. And they like to eat men, humans. Fee, fi, fo, fum, I smell the blood of the English bum, you know, whatever, yeah. So, what happens is, when we die, our tissues are moist. And then when they dry out, they go through a process that turns into calcium carbonate, which is the same thing as limestone and lots of rock. I don't want to go into it, you guys, because I'm going to mess it up. This is Roger's thing. He's been in it a whole long time. So if you want to know about mud fossils, go on YouTube, Mud Fossil University. Roger will break it down. The only warning I want to give you is that Roger, an old dude, and he's trying to under, he's waking up like us, and he knows all about Nephilims and the way tendons dry and become hard as rock, and how those big, round, what looks like rock balls, everyone's discovering them all over the place. Those are ball and socket joints that harden. That was a big Nephilim's ball and socket joint, you guys, a hip ball. That's what that big rock ball is. Nobody carved it. Come on, you guys. And all these ancient civilizations with these walls that fit perfect together, you can't even stick a piece of paper between them. They're just no cement, just perfectly. And each one weighs like 100,000 tons. Come on, man. Come on. I know the cognitive dissonance virus is out there, but guys, Aztecs, Mayans, we don't have anything that can lift 100,000 tons, you guys. How are they going to have something that could? It's because before it solidified, turned into that stone or whatever, it was flesh. It was still wet. Okay? And what they did was they were able to, our bodies, it's like little building blocks of that flesh. It's like when you look at a muscle under the microscope, you can see the little blocks. That's how God did it. It's like God's a builder, and he just put blocks of flesh. Well, you know, that's just the way it is. And of course, the blood all going through the arteries. That's why a lot of these pyramids, this is going to blow your mind. But the pyramid was not built from the ground up, guys. It was a Nephilim. It was a really mile tall giant. Okay? And it was, the flesh was still wet. And what they did was they took out the building blocks from top down. And what ended up was the shape of a pyramid. Right? Because no, man, they didn't have slaves carrying them up. Okay, you guys, come on.
This one up over by NC State. It's
what makes more sense? I mean, if you know how the body, and I'm not an expert, but Roger is. Well, yeah, what I'm saying is the pyramids, they're finding all these tunnel systems. You know, that you can walk through, and they're perfectly round. Now, how is a civilization going to carve out all these tunnel systems inside perfectly? You know why? They're the Nephilim's arteries where the blood went through. And when they dried out and the blood got squirted out, all that was left was the artery. And then it solidified, and that's how they could walk. It's not just the pyramids. The old South American, Mayan, they have inside of those ancient structures, was all kinds of tunnels. And some of those ancient civilizations, their houses were made out of Nephilims. That's how they built houses, out of Nephilim flesh. They built a house, and then it dried, and they lived in it. And you think, oh, what, they was living in giant flesh? Yeah! And in Colorado, the red dust, the dirt, and in Australia, the red clay looking, that's Nephilim blood dried up. Come on, guys, this was like thousands of years ago. Just, it had a long time to dry and dust up from weathering, fine, real fine dust. And when blood dries, and it's super, all the moisture, then yeah, it's just like that red, what you think is dirt, it's Nephilim blood. More literally, living on a bunch of dead Nephilim. I know, that's real shocking. But I just invite you, Mud Fossil University, because Roger is unbelievable at teaching about, I don't know if this is the right word, pre-diluvium, whatever, before the flood. But, cuidado, he is a stubborn old dude, and he's waking up, and he's still stuck on heliocentrism, and space is real, and he's trying to figure it out. But a lot of us that can see through the heliocentrism line trying to help Roger. Roger, come on, man, we respect you. Nobody break down the pre-flood the way things were except you. And he gets confused sometimes, like, he found a dragon, you know, the Bible talks about the dragons, yeah, you know, and the dinosaurs, because there's a lot of DNA sorcery, remember, guys? And he found a big dragon in the desert, when I say big, I'm talking like miles. That's how, it's hard to fathom, but you gotta think outside the box. If you're gonna wake up, don't limit how much you wake up. Just keep it open. Otherwise, you're going to get whiplash and maybe break your dang neck. Watch that. Cognitive dissonance. Because they're little fallen angels. And plus, if you're not fully saved in the blood of Jesus, and you're a truther, but you haven't gotten... That's how it's going to go for you, brothers and sisters. You're going to get to a point, like I did, where it's either... continue on, but you gotta accept that Jesus is the Lord and Savior. If you don't, that's where it's gonna stop for you. And then you're gonna be questioning stuff like, because you're still gonna have fallen angels whispering in your ear, and you're gonna be like, still confused. But if you get saved, after that it gets real, much, much easier. Much, much easier. You know, it's like Bob Marley. I know the world is rocky. Sure sounds good to me. You know, he might have meant something different. I wasn't there. But, to me, what that means is, this whole truthing exploration can get rocky, frustrating, confusing. That's why I put Flat Earth Man's music videos, the conspiracy music guru. This whole breakdown gravity. He'll break down fake NASA. He'll break down all the main top deceptions in a musical fashion, and it's real nice. You know? I put them all on my Facebook because I don't know how to download it yet to my iMac and then put them on my YouTube channel. So otherwise, I only got videos of myself on YouTube. But I don't know how to put videos of other people that I think should be on there. I would. I'd put the first ones I put is all conspiracy music gurus. Gravity, the Freemason G is not God, it's gravity. Isaac Newton was a damn Mason. And you know, his 7 or 8 whatever music videos about how space is fake. There's bubbles and harnesses. They're all actors. You know, they have a special airplane, NASA, and they do a dive. And it make it look like they're floating. And then they turn on the camera and say, hey, we're live from the space station. Nah, man. They're just in one of their dives. And it looks like it's weightlessness. So he can break it all down. It's fake satellites and no satellites. You know. Yeah. He helped me so much. Yeah, that's why I classify conspiracy music guru. I didn't. Job did. Jah tag team. And now he's a Hope Rockiora Double D. Delphi Disciple. And he gonna be teaching a class. Rockiora and the rest of the land of the Long White Cloud and the rest of the, you know, we're gonna beam it all out like that movie Heat, the guy in the wheelchair. That tall dude, you know, he's a great actor, that guy. But, you know, Angela Jolene's father, what's his name? You know, the guy in the Ray, Donovan, plays the father. He's a great actor, too. But he's a fake Jew. I mean, when that fake Jews do the fundraising thing, and they all do the dancing with the stupid hats, you know, and they're all dancing, and they got their little curls. You know, he come on, and he's all, I knew that, I was like, man, what are you doing with the synagogue of Satan's? Asking for money, what else is new? Always about money, synagogues of Satan's. You know, we had a guy in my town, South Jersey, Hamilton, and we called him Hamilton Harry. I kind of feel bad, but grade 8, he used to come walk around the school grounds, and we messed with him. I feel bad, I really do. I feel, you don't even know how I feel. I feel bad we messed with Hamilton and Harry, because I was there. I was a free range, feral human. He was an old dude, and he was obviously not all there. Throw pennies, and every time he'd go, pick them up, and then we throw them again, and he'd pick them up, and I feel real bad, Hamilton Harry. I know, that was 1986, you know, it was real doubtful. He's still even alive, but I'm sure God had a special place for you, Hamilton Harry. I'm sure he did, because I feel real bad, and I wouldn't feel bad if he was a bad person. But we was mobbed up school kids for the most part. Not me so much, because I was trying to tell you how mob families do it. The top mobsters, they don't want their kids to go into the mafia. They want them to be doctors and lawyers and all that. You know, Michael Corleone was in the army before his father got shot and his brother Sonny. And I'm more Sonny, my brother James is more Michael. You know, he's like the good kid. I'm like the, my temper, you know. Like I said, I do. I take fools out if I have to. You know what I'm saying? That's just different personalities. Anyway, I was talking about, you know, the sins of our father, because a lot of kids,
your music,
in my graduating class, heroin overdose, that was the thing. South Jersey kids with the heroin from Philly. God took a lot of them. I don't know if it was from the sins of the father. I don't. I was not there. The decision was made. I wasn't there. But Bible talks about sins of the father, and that could be in a good paragon or whatever. The perfect example. Hold on. We still going. Alright. Damn, we's at about to be 2 hours. I said there was gonna be a bench clearing and I'm already in another period. The flow just flows. If I try to control it, I could just be like, what? I'm stubborn, God. You can't use my body. You can't use my, you know. When you're scared to let God talk through you, you know, like most of the politicians, they read off the thing, and everybody was mesmerized by Trump, because he didn't use a, it wasn't scripted, he was just flowing, and everyone was like, that's what they were feeling the flow, that's why they was all mesmerized, you know, and, but you can practice that too, if you're not righteous. Trump ain't righteous, he's a Knight of Malta, or a Knight of Columbus, I wasn't there, but he's one of them secret society fools, you know. And when I grew up, he was my hero. But it took a while, and then I saw a picture of his two kids, sons, in Africa, with a leopard over their shoulder they just killed. And then it's talking about how they was gonna eat it. And there's this thing about eating wild game called some kind of flesh disease, a stupid kid. Pissed me off seeing the leopard over there. They were so proud. They probably hired a local Afrikaner to help him hunt down a leopard, and they probably shot him. It was like, high five! And what's Trump's kid's name? Eric and Don Jr. They're probably like, high five, brother! We just shot a leopard! Let's go eat him! So stupid. I hope you get kuru or whatever. Flesh disease called. But anyway, saying you can practice, you know? And a lot of these televangelists, they look like they love Jesus. They don't. They're lizards and wolves in sheep's clothing, false prophets, but they practice. They've been practicing since like many, many long time. Kenneth Copeland, he's probably the worst of the worst. Yeah, you, Kenneth, I'm coming to get you. Like a thief in the night. Knock, knock, what's up? Time for judge. You be in your mansion or one of your $10 million airplanes, probably $50 million, I don't know. But I'm gonna get you. Jah gonna get you through me. Oh yeah, it's coming. It's coming. Got a nice little spot in the lake of fire for the Kenneth Copelands. A lot of them in Texas. You know, there's that one father and son. Now the son's more popular than the father. You know? I don't know the names because I don't pay them much attention, but I do know this. There's just two options, you guys. Your name is either going to go in the book of life where you get green lighted and you with Jah and Jesus. Or you go in the other book you don't want to go in.
Hi, it's John.
And if you're naming that book, then your future is looking real bad. Bleak, if that's the proper word. What would have been ya? Might have been ya when I was up to all my clockwork oranges. You know? But not no more. Not as of 2000 and, you know, when my tour ended in 2016, it took me another 2 years, but as of 2 months ago, that's it. It's official. What you're looking at is a Jesus freak. Proud of it. You know? I stand with Mel Gibson. I stand with Jim Kavazibazibazibazib. Yeah, because Jim Kavazibazibazib, that he might be a Hollywood actor, but Jim Kavazibazibazib is not drinking blood and not eating poop, and neither is Mel Gibson. Because they're always coming at Mel Gibson. And I don't know if Mel Gibson is still a Catholic. If he is, he's confused. Which is natural. Because it's very rare to find someone who can understand as well as I and I from Poker Class, Philadelphia Class. But Mel has been trying, can't you tell? All that alcoholism? Because he got confused and people was taking advantage of him. I mean, he had succubus wife making him yell at her on the phone. They recorded it. Them dudes from the paparazzis recorded it and blasted it all for everybody to see. But that's the best thing for Mel. Because then he wasn't worried about what people was thinking no more. You know what I mean? And then he played the game a little bit with the beaver. The beaver thing. I haven't seen it. Jodie Foster. But the last couple movies since they got blacklisted them were good. When he plays to rescue his daughter. Blood of the Father or something like that. And then, of course, the war movie, you know, with that skinny dude that plays the soldier, the objective, he won't carry a gun, he won't kill nobody. But he ends up saving and rescuing a lot of soldiers, putting them on his shoulder. That's Mel Gibson's, that was incredible. Mel Gibson is back. And he about to come out with Passion of the Christ Part 2, The Resurrection. Oh boy, look out. Oh yeah, look out, you're about to get blasted, Hollywood. Is Mel Gibson coming back with the part 2? You seen how they did Jesus. Now, you're gonna see after the Resurrection. I don't know. I wasn't there. But that's what it looked like, and Jim Caviezel is playing Jesus again. And Jim Caviezel, he is well saved. Oh yeah. And he's playing the Hollywood game. He's about to come out with a movie about St. Paul, I think. Or maybe St. Luke. Something. He's about to come out with it. Because he's well saved. And he's trying to say, I'll play the Hollywood game, but I'm gonna be putting how it really is, because he's serving Jesus. Did you know that when he acted in Mel Gibson's Passion of the Christ, he got struck by lightning? The cross that he had to carry, his arm got pulled out of its socket. He suffered just like Jesus suffered. That's Jim Caviezel, and he's always been one of my favorites, you know? I just always liked his flow. And now I know he's well saved, blood of Jesus. So that's a good, that's a good point right there, because you can't just say all of Hollywood is witches and he witches and blood drinkers and poop eaters. Because, damn, that's nice. Is that the same one? Sound like, is that a boy or a girl? I don't know. That's a pretty voice though, whatever. I'm a super fan. That thing's been blown for 2 years. He's up, it's like 20 years ago. He's still died though. Anyone want to have a catch? 5 miles from Duke.
Giving some love to Goldsboro this weekend.
Let's
me and Morgan are going to be at the Walmarts
on Friday, 7th and 11th
on Saturday.
Then I want to go outside now and play lacrosse.
4:30 to 4:30.
Hopefully, my neighbor Kim can't hit the solid comfort. Too bad yet. Yeah. So, That's a good song, but the kind. It's my put on the whole armor guy. Special demon gloves. The kind. Put on your own whole armor guy. I got a sword. I got a staff. Practice jiu-jitsu. Some might practice bo-jitsu. Man, that's a good reminder, Jeff. I was going into a story a while ago about the samurais. What happened was they used to carry two swords, a katana or a tachi, and a wakakashi, smaller one. And whoever was in charge, powers to be in Japan, decided, I can't be having all these samurais, they're real good swords people, walking around, because they're going to be a threat to my power. So he outlaws swords. Yeah. And a lot of people on farms used to carry water, you know, up here. They had a big bucket hanging from that side and that side. And anytime someone would come mess with them, they didn't have their sword. So, they just took that there piece of wood and started learning how to manipulate it. So if they ever got threatened, someone tried to just come and take what they had, the little they had, there's just little farmers, you know? Then, bad, they didn't have a sword to chop them down, but little by little, you could chop down a big tree with just your little wood staff. Especially if you know what you're doing. So, I like to practice all kind of martial arts. You know, whether it just be regular striking, from what I learned in Taekwondo. You know, Taekwondo is Taekwondo. You know, get your white belt with one yellow stripe, two yellow stripes. Jiu-Jitsu doing the same thing. Y'all, thank you. Mightier, holier than thou. You're doing the same thing. Pay a certain amount each month. I'll give you this blue with the red, and then another red, and then I give you the... What comes after blue? I don't know. I didn't do jiu-jitsu. I don't want to be rolling around with another dude, okay? Maybe it was like co-ed jiu-jitsu. You know what I'm saying? And, that Polish girl, you know? You know, 115-pound Polish girl, if she was my jiu-jitsu partner, okay, cool. Or Rose Naman Yunus, sorry, Pat Barry. I just had to use that as a gamble, because Rose is beautiful, man. Rose, like everyone said, she real pretty. But she got thorns. That's why she busted up Joanna. Joanna the alien. If aliens were real, Joanna had all kind of fallen angels biting on her, man. She thought she was the everything. And Rose, the last time they faced off, Joanna was all with them. She bends down and she puts the fist up against the chin. And Rose just stood there with her stoicism, you know, and whispered the Lord's Prayer, which is important to us. Heaven on earth is from the Lord's Prayer. The promise of a heaven on earth kingdom come from the Lord's Prayer. You know, in other places mentions a new Jerusalem. But you guys don't get it twisted up. Just because it says New Jerusalem does not mean it's going to be Jerusalem in Israel. I mean, just if you're God and you're looking down and you see how it's all working, where's the beast system base operations on earth? Dang right, fake Jews, Khazars, State of Israel. I mean, they're not even supposed to be there. If they're Jewish, if they're Israelites, I mean, you know, I don't even know what the word Jew means. But if they're thinking they're really from the 12 tribes of Israel, it says in the Bible, you are not to return to the promised land, Israel, until the Messiah comes back and grabs you up and walks you back to Israel. Why are they there? Okay, so they don't think Jesus is the Messiah. Well, we all know Jesus hasn't come back. Okay, but if they're there, then their Messiah must have come back, right, guys? Right, because it says it right there in their Old Testament. Don't be coming back to Israel until your Messiah comes to get you. Did their Messiah come get them and bring them in 1940, whatever? When the Rothschilds put the money down for, you know, all them Illuminati puppets to go establish the State of Israel? I don't think so, unless I missed something. Did their Messiah come down, y'all? Is the Jewish Messiah on Earth right now? Because if he's not, why are you in God's land? You're all supposed to be waiting in the wilderness. I'm not making this up. Go look it up. I mean, that's the main... If you're confused, who are these Jews? Why is he calling the synagogue of Satan? Why does he keep calling them Khazars? Because any Israeli history person will tell you 90% of them are from the DNA or line of Khazaria, which is in the Caucasus Mountains area. They all come from there. And they all practice Babylonic cult. Why do you think they chose the Star of David, which is the Star of Remphan, Acts 7:43? And I can just see the comments, once they catch wind, they're just going to be busting down, man. Hey, man, with their little funny hat. Oh, let me just tell you something about that hat. I don't know the name. I don't care. But let me tell you something about it. They want to say it's their thing with God. Let me tell you something. All them old Jewish dudes, they be getting a big old bald spot up there. Yeah. And they're subconscious. A Jewish person, the most subconscious person of all. Woody Allen, all them neuroticisms. All them little neuroticisms. Because they're subconscious. Because their mothers, we always berating them. And they don't know how to handle it. My mom always berating me. Well, I just got humbled from it. You know what I'm saying? I don't need my mom to be like, oh my God, you're like perfect. And I don't need it. In fact, she might say, give me a compliment once every 10 years if I'm lucky. I mean, she's like Abby Lee Miller, Dance Moms. That's my mom. She's Sicilian, and she ain't always doting on me. She's keeping me in check. And that's what I need, apparently. Because she loves me, you know what I'm saying? No matter how much she'd be like, if I do something unbelievable, she'd be like, oh, is that it? You know what I'm saying? And that's Abby Lee Miller. That's how she was. And her kids was the best dancers. So it works for some people, obviously. It did for me. My best coaches were the ones that broke me down. That pulled something out of me. Oh, there Jimmy Cliff go. How this? Oh, it turned dark right when he said that. Looks like we in the flow, y'all. Who in there with me? Anybody? Lou from the Dome. I'm gonna face it out with Jimmy, you guys. I know I'm into all kinds of stories. That's just the way it goes. Take it up with management, I'm telling you. I'm just a vessel. And I'm not perfect at it. But one good thing that came out of the whole transcendental meditation trap is a lot of that yogic stretching. Because I got real flexible. And before that, I was an athlete. Lacrosse. I mean, I've done it all. High school, I started with cross country. I tried tennis that spring. And in the winter, I did squash. Yeah, that's a real preppy sport. Squash. And then the sophomore, fall, I tried football. But I didn't like it. I didn't like wearing all that helmets and pads. I just was intellectualizing. My friend Drew Gibson was big into football. I wanted to hang out with him. But I stopped. And in that winter, sophomore year, squash. And then spring, sophomore year, lacrosse. JV team. Where me and Ogden, he played defense. I played offense, attack. And it was middies. Junior year was fall. I don't know. But winter, basketball. Because I knew these two twins, the Shockey twins, who end up selling me out. And that's what got me kicked out. Because we prank called 911. And everybody was like, we ain't gonna rat each other out. There's only six of us. But the dean of students thought he was some kind of cop. Or us into the office, and he had a real cop there. I guess trying to intimidate us. And he recorded it. Brought us in one by one. I was the third one to go in, and two Shockies were the first two to go in. When I went in, he asked me what happened. I was just like, I don't know. I don't know. And then he played the tape. You know how the cops do? They try to show you what the other person said. He played Matt Shockey, the twin I wasn't that much friends with. He was just stupid, Matt Shockey. And when my friend Ian Ogden, like I said, playing defense, Matt Shockey was playing offense. And Ian got, during practice, we had to hit each other. And Ian Ogden went and smacked Matt. Broke his collarbone. It was beautiful. I don't care how that sounds. I was loving it. I seen Matt crumble to the ground. My shoulder. And he could... Ogden broke his collarbone all to pieces. And he was crying like a little baby, Matt Shockey. I'll never forget that, Ogden. Even if he is all about... the Giants. Can't even win a damn football game. I'm trying to tell me my Eagles ain't got no game. What now, sucker? You and your Eagles ain't got no Super Bowl rings. Well, I'm pretty sure we do now. And maybe next year we're gonna get another one. Ain't got nobody. When Carson Wentz and Nick Foles battle it out for who's gonna be quarterback, they're gonna make the whole team come up. Oh, we had to go stomp on everybody next year. Anyway, what I'm saying is, the dean of students, Mr. Rockwell, played me Matt Shockey. And he all, it was Charlie. No, it's Chuck. They called me Chuck. It was Chuck. Chuck did it. Chuck made the call to the 911. Then, I was like, yeah, okay. And then he goes, yeah, but you know, your friend Alex sold you out too. I was like, no. Alex said he wasn't. They all said they weren't gonna do it. But Alex was my best friend, I thought. Well, I guess him and his twin brother got together and said, we gonna sell Chuck out. And he did. I heard Alex. It was Chuck. Chuck did. Chuck picked up the phone. Dialed 911. Told the operator to gobble up his nuts. Yeah, I did. I told the 911 operator. I said, I said, we're having an emergency in Mercersburg. I said, we're all real stressed out, and we're going to explode. We need you to come here and give us all BJs, because we're just about to explode. That was very uncharacteristic of him, too. But I think Guy wanted me to get kicked out. You know what I'm saying? So I could go to Hawaii. Oh, yeah, I was into that story. Yeah, I didn't last the public school because it was stupid. And I already did all that stuff he was doing. It was just dumb. I was used to sleeping in on one day. Every Wednesday, we got a half a day. You know, and in college school, you start at 8 and you end at like 3. And when you get like a so-called break, study hall, you can't even put your head down and take a nap in the cafeteria with the blazing lights. If you put your head down, they're like, wake up, you can't sleep, that's stupid. Prep school, at least we got to, there's a classroom building, we got to walk back to the dorm, climb in bed if you want, turn on the music, put on the fan. 2 hours later, if we went back to class, it wasn't so dang stressed, but right, public school, they go 8 a.m. to 3 a.m., and it's just like robots. No break or nothing. That's how they indoctrinate, so it's much easier to indoctrinate a public school purse kid than a boarding prep school kid, boarding school, because you get to go sleep in your room, or whatever. Unless you come from maybe an old rich East Coast family, it's probably harder for them because their parents be like, you know, bring them up thinking they better than everybody, and they get used to that. And then when it come to hear some blood and poop, they're like, anybody thinking, and they're like, but I want to respect my dad, and they eat up that poop and drink that blood and become witches like their father, go on the Wall Street, cast spells, and all that stuff that them real wealthy one percenters do, you know? Pinky wavers, I call them, you know. Yeah. This has been a long one, guys. What? 227, wow. That's like, you know, our motto, basically, the Heaven on Earth Project is, Jazz says, jump, we say, how high, when, where, and how, right, right? And if he says, like the movie where in London, they scope out where all the diamond exchange that had never been robbed, nobody wanted to go to that level, and they robbed it. John's like, I want you to rob that diamond exchange. I'm like, when, where, how, and who, and this, and that. You know, I don't be like, I can't do that. That's against the law. I just don't do it. And forever all them lawmakers is watching. Hey, man, you already know that about me. I mean, that was what you wanted, liked about me, was my... I didn't follow designated, you know, whatnots. And we had that agreement, and if you break it, I'm gonna break you. You know what I'm saying? We had that agreement. You know what I'm saying? If you,
your life, your music, 96.
Bust you up if you break that agreement. We got that unwritten, unspoken thing, and you do your thing.
Still seeing things moving along fairly well.
And I'm gonna
right
do my little,
RTP,
my little thing in this little area of the world.
Coming off of the
you know what I'm saying? Landed a long white cloud.
Exits continuing to the I-40 Wade Avenue.
I like to say.
Inbound Wade Avenue.
New land of zeal.
The Beltline, but on the Beltline.
Y'all do. Y'all got the whole dang flat earth. Man. Delay. But that's maybe it right there. You know, that's that got designated Heaven on Earth Project.
Road,
starting with rock
and
roll.
See, no?
Stay out of my way. Stay out of your way. That's it. That's it. And I know John told me today he's going to come and y'all going to break up the agreement. I'm just saying. I already told you I'm going to have my orcas and dolphins and tunas and all of that. And it's going to protect us. So, you know, you want to bring your submarines and bass, it's going to get busted up. I'm orcas, beluga whales. And I was just reading about that. The U.S. Navy's mammal mammalian, ocean mammalian soldier program. Started in the 60s, you guys.
The North Carolina Wild and Deer Festival, presented by Food Lion, is coming
dolphins
to the farm on
beluga
Saturday,
whales,
April 7th.
And
more than 100 different wines to sample from the mountains to the coast, including
200
vineyards,
feet
fish
underwater.
Duplin, Gregory Vineyards,
and the
more.
Sea lion can
Craft
swim right down, dolphin can swim
brewing,
right down to
deep
the installation. Start
Carolina
teaching them.
And more.
Go get
live
this, bring it here,
the
bring it there. And they used them in Vietnam, you guys, when the U.S. was at their ship around Vietnam. They had dolphins that protected
the
ship. So if the Vietnam sent underwater soldiers to attack, put a bomb against the ship, we're trying to board, the dolphin would just bust them up. No. Well, they said the dolphin would just tag them, stick something on them, and then light them up, and then soldiers would kick them out. And but a lot of we're saying, well, we saw before it was redacted, because they made all this public, like around when the Soviet Union fell, they made the whole, you know, water mammalian dolphin soldier program with the Navy, they made it public record, but they redacted some stuff, of course, and some were saying that these dolphins were even trained to take these divers out. Not just tag them, take them out. Like as if, imagine a dolphin with arms shooting the Vietnamese guy. Yeah. But, you know, obviously they had some kind of system. I don't know what it was. But the dolphin could easily just see the Vietnamese and take him out somehow with some kind of weapon. The Navy said, "Nah, we ain't do that. You know, we taught him to tag stuff, but we never taught the dolphins to kill him. Guess that was crossing the line. I mean, it's okay to like blast up the damn biosphere with a bunch of nukes and." I can start listing all the things they've done. It's real bad, but dolphins killing Vietnamese during the Vietnam War. No, we didn't do that. No, yeah. They used them in the Middle East too. Yeah, they used them and they phased out most of the dolphin soldier programs. Mammalian some. U.S. Navy started in the 1960s. But, you know, there's some guy in Florida who you try to release him back in the wild and, you know, teach him how to not be little robots. But, he had a couple that he was supposed to let go. But the Navy kept saying, no, no, they weren't putting the paperwork through. And he knew they was going to grab, the Navy was going to grab them back. So he let him go. Two of them. And the Navy went, and what'd they do? They went and snatched one of them back. And now that one is in that program right now. And that guy in Florida knew, and he put himself on the line. I don't know his name. I plug him, but I don't know his name. So, you know, that's all real, you guys. And nobody's talking about Orca, but, I mean, they probably ain't gonna talk about because they don't want nobody to learn how to get on the respectful level with an orca. Because the orcas work as a team. Oh, yeah, no. Other dolphins do too. Yeah, but I know. The orcas, oh boy. Be careful. Cuidado. Because, I mean, they're smart. Oh, damn. They are so smart. And they work as a team. I mean, the way they strategize orcas are just crazy. I mean, they're awesome. And to think they put them in little pools in SeaWorld, and then when one of them bit one of the SeaWorld trainers that tries to get him to do tricks and flick him a fish, turn him into a beggar. They got surprised when one of them bit up on the ankle and dragged him down to the bottom and almost drowned him. A couple of them did get drowned, and They was real shocked, like, oh my god, the orcas rebelled. You know, and I don't even know if SeaWorld even has orcas no more. I don't, I wasn't there, I haven't been keeping, you know. I just put that hole in my mind only like a month ago. And, you know, so I'm looking into some stuff. The laser, potential of laser. You won't see me carrying a firearm. Never, never. I mean, I mentioned that I really like air guns. And I did mention that I really wanted the Sig Sauer. Because it's very much like the real Sig Sauer. But a lot of companies do that. Replicas. They make it so it's all metal and the same weight. So it don't have to be a Sig Sauer. You know, if anybody wants to send me something that I really want, it don't gotta be the Sig Sauer. But I do, I can tell you what is number one on my bucket list right now, you guys, is the Umarex Beretta air pistol automatic. It could be either semi or automatic, meaning I don't know how many BBs it holds in a clip, but basically, you clip it up, it might be 22, and it's just a pistol, but it's got blowback, meaning it feel when you shoot it, it feels like a real blowback, it's called. It shoots like a machine gun, a little pistol goes, it's awesome. Awesome. And that, it's only like $120 on eBay. You know, Umarex Beretta. And of course, I love the Beretta. You know, it's all Italian sounding. Everybody can use the Beretta. It's like, oh, the Beretta's the bomb. You know what I mean? It's all about Beretta. Usually, if you want a firearm that's Beretta, I don't know, thousands of dollars or something. But the air gun's $120. It's totally legal. I can take it to a park. You know, I mean, shoot targets. I mean, there's no rules. So that's why I try to tell you all is about all these kids in Florida that are spazzing out. That girl with those shaved head, she on her way to a padded room, man. And the other dude with the arms that are like that big around, man, eat a sandwich. No, eat five sandwiches. Because you worried about something. Why are your arms so skinny, man? That don't look right, dude. I think you're worried about how you look or something. Emaciated. And then, of course, there's the other boy who's the grandson of the woman, Crow Chocolatier, in Trump's Castle. My mom used to be the manager of Crow Chocolatier. That's her grandson. Caskey family. It's a synagogue of Satan, fake Jew family, the Caskeys. Always thinking they're better than everybody. Oh yeah, I was telling you about Hamilton Harry. The way we made him pick up the pens. You know, that's who Jewish people really are. They're just a bunch of Hamilton Harrys. You all know that. I'm not telling you nothing you don't know. You throw a bunch of pennies in a synagogue, man, you're gonna have a riot. Oh yeah, the funny hats they wear. That's to cover the bald spot, man. That's it. That's all it is. That's just to cover the bald spot. Yeah, man, I'm talking like it is. I mean, you're all confused about these people, these fake Jews. Like I said, they're not even supposed to be in Israel. If they're Israelites, they're supposed to be waiting for the Messiah. And I know their dang Messiah ain't. Nobody said, well, our Messiah returned. We can go back to the Israel. Synagogue of Satan. Mark of the Beast. Star of Red Fan. What's Hexagonic the Star. They call Star of David. Ain't. Solomon.
Done.
Dabbled in the cult. His son Menelik seen it, got pissed, took the Ark of the Covenant to Ethiopia. And now, it being guarded by an old Ethiopian with his staff in a little structure with no lock. That's where the Ark of the Covenant is, you guys. Isn't that funny, man? Oh my god, that kills me. That kills me. You see on National Geographic and they're like talking about the Ark of the Covenant. Where is it? Where is it? Where is it? Oh, the consensus is it's in Ethiopia because Menelik took it to Ethiopia. And now the high priestesses of the Ethiopian Christian church or even Jewish, I don't know what they are. They all dressed up in their red, green, gold and black stuff, garb, robes, and got his staff, his little fence that come up to his knees. And he looked like he could just flick them. He's going to topple over. He's so old. Like, that's what he's been doing his whole life. He just, like them guys that stand outside a castle in the UK. That's his job. He just stand there like, ain't nobody getting to the Ark of the Covenant. Send the U.S. Army. All the four militaries and Coast Guard, send them all against me. I got my staff, and my little 2-foot fence, and if you get past that, I got my little structure without a lock. Oh my God, that kills me. I mean, does anybody believe that? I mean, I bet somebody are like, no, I mean, it really is in Ethiopia. It's being guarded by the high priestesses. And it's because God's protecting it. Well, you know, we all know that, you know, sometimes Satan and his cohorts get past God's defenses. Come on, guys. I mean, God's all knowing and all powerful, yeah, but, you know, I don't know if you do it on purpose and let Lucifer get little, move his pawns here and there to maybe test our faith, resolve. Maybe that's how I wasn't there. I'm not up there. I'm not in the conversation. You know, I just try to be a vessel. But kind of makes sense, right? If he's all powerful and Nephilims and DNA sorcery and all this stuff's happening, maybe he just wants to watch and see which one of us we want to have in the kingdom of heaven on earth. Yeah, yeah. No, that makes sense, right? I mean, you gotta test people. And you can't just be like, oh, it's unlimited space. Every 7 billion of you is get to be in my heaven on earth kingdom. Even all you pedophiles, all you baby sacrificers, you poop eaters, feces freaks, blood drinkers, all y'all come in. All y'all come in. Come on. Space is limited, extremely limited. So, yeah, God is testing us. So when it looked like Satan's making little advances, just don't forget God's allowing that to happen. To watch us, how are we going to react? Are we going to lose our faith? Or are we going to be like Job and remain steadfast? Are we going to be like the Smyrnans, one of the original seven churches? And no matter how many times we get persecuted, we remain steadfast. We're gonna be like the Philadelphians. Yeah. Remain righteous through it all. Or we're gonna be like the Laodiceans and be lukewarm. You know what I'm saying? Or we're gonna be like, you know, I just named 3 of the 7. There's other ones. God's favorite was just 2 of them. Philadelphia class and Smyrnans. You know? Yeah, there's 5 other. The Laodiceans were lukewarm. This is Revelation 3, you guys. Alright? Revelation 3, verses 7 through 12. Tell you all about the Church of Philadelphia. Like my mom said, go look it up. But Revelation 3, tell you all about the other churches. And the other 5, besides Philadelphia and Smyrna. Laodicea is your lukewarm. There's the backsliders. You ever heard that term? Christians that are backsliders. That means they're Christians. They want to be known as Christians. But as soon as their faith is tested, they backslide. They'd be like, oh, well, I'll be a Christian when it suits me. You know what I'm saying? When they give their tithe, their 10%, like when Melchizedek, the king of Salem, which means peace, you know, Melchizedek, which means righteousness, pretty sure, I mean, I just glanced over that, but it came out right, so maybe I got it right. Y'all can verify that, whatever. But, that's how the 10% started, see? Abraham was kicking ass and taking names, conquering lands for Jah. And he came across Melchizedek, who was a high priest in God's favor. And Melchizedek was talking to Abraham, and he was like, God's gonna intervene for you. And Abraham remembered that after he done took all that stuff from them Luciferians, you know, Moabites. Well, that was with Joshua. I'd say I don't know the Bible that well. I really don't. Stuff just pops in my head. But I do remember Joshua, when he was kicking ass and taking names, he came up and these people start approaching him. This is a good place. Maybe to finish, you guys. It's a good lesson to learn. Joshua was kicking much ass. He was taking back Israel from God. And him and his army, which is large and in charge, these people started approaching lots of them, but they were dressed in ratty old clothes. Their sandals was all broke up. It looked like they had been walking for miles and miles forever, because God told Joshua. He told him.
Over towards US 1, no problems on US 1 south from Cary down to Apex.
None of these neighboring
headed down to Johnson County. Expect those delays as everything gets crowded up on Exit 301 on down past.
They're all wicked.
Visit Johnson Hundy of Cary during the season. More sales
and no.
Get the best service.
They told
Joshua the largest selection, including the new
2018 Joshua
Elantra.
Was doing that. He was taking them all out. He was sleeping all of them.
Dealer, right here in the Cary Auto Mall or at Johnson Hundy.
But then these,
I'm Mike Riddle, 96.1 BBB.
Moabites. From Moab, and the Moabites were your lawyer types. They knew how to talk real well with the fancy word and the way they, you know, the way the lawyers master, you know, become a good talking head, you know, like that band Talking Heads, you know. Moabites, that's what they was. They was lawyers, like the Pharisees. And they knew that Joshua was busting everybody up that was in the neighboring land. So, they want to make it look like, see what I'm getting at? With the ratted up sandals and broke up clothes. And oh yeah, they even made the food, the little food they had, purposely made it all moldy and rotten because Joshua smelt it. And he was like, oh, they must have been walking for a long time. They must have come from real long way. Because look, their food, they barely have any left. The bread is all moldy. Look at the sandals. They've been walking forever. Look at it's all, yeah, Moabites. So, Joshua said, okay, God, these obviously are not from around here. And he didn't counsel with God. That's why it's so important. You gotta counsel with the Lord. You gotta get to know him. Like I said, I'm more with the Christadelphians, not on everything, but about that, not the Catholic Father, Son, Holy Ghost, Trinity. I'm more Jah, and then to Jah's right on the throne is Jesus. Two different. You see what I'm saying? God and His only begotten Son. It's not just one Father, Son, Holy Ghost. That's a Catholic thing. And they're just a bunch of liars, isn't it? Fishman worshippers, man. not Marianne, Jesus. Nimrod's wife in Tammuz. That's what that is. They're the worst of the worst. The white pope, the Vatican, and then the black pope, the Jesuits. Which the white pope was Jesuit. And you know, the trinity of evil. Basically, because everyone's trying to, like, who is the all-seeing eye, you know, on the dollar? Well, yeah, that's Lucifer, obviously. And, what's right under that? Well, yeah, it's pretty damn obvious it's the royal family. Oh, man. All the way things have been changing. Still with the royal family this whole time. So, they try to make it look like they ain't got much influence, but that's one of the legs of the trinity of evil, is the royals, Queen Elizabeth and all of it, Prince Charles. And that's why I don't like to be called Charles, because of that fool right there. Charlie, Chaz, Chukaroo, whatever, but just don't call me Charles, unless you're like some kind of official position and I don't know you yet. Maybe I make you call me Charles.
More amazing variety.
I classify you as a friend. Friendly. But anyway,
hey, if you're in
royals,
right now, stop by
white pope,
Laura,
black pope. That's it right there, okay? That's the three legs of the evil axis. Royals, black pope, white pope. Vatican, Jesuit. And, yeah, not much is coming in my head no more. I guess that's it, you guys. I might have started a lot and didn't finish some. I'm sorry. Ask me some. Just ask. I'll tell you. I'm not good at typing. You'll see a lot of type errors. I don't worry about going back and correcting them. I'll do maybe, if it gets real bad, I'll correct it. You know, like my friend Mushroom John. So it's like, I'm half blind, I can only see out of one eye, and I'm old, and I can't be reading your comments if you don't know how to word them properly. Man, John, little crybaby, you're like the oldest crybaby I've ever met. I don't care if you can't read them, Mushroom John, I just don't care. Watch my videos, watch me talk. I know you like your movies. You're living in that little shit room. But yet, half of it was full of old VHS movies, and you had a big old TV. So watch, if you don't want to read my type error, watch the flow. That's it. Y'all take care, right? It's like March 21 or something. There go the screensaver, because my clicker went into one of the corners, man. I don't know how to correct that. That's why I'm looking for Mr. Robot, you know what I'm saying? Because Mrs. Robot, she ain't here all the time. And, you know, we do a lot of emails. I can't be asking her every time I cursor go into one of the corners and the screensaver come on. I can't be like, Mrs. Robot, how do I fix that? I gotta learn some stuff on my own, you know what I mean? Can't be asking her. But if I need her to track a damn Freemason pedophile, well, yeah, then I'm gonna ask her to do that. You can't be asking your best people to wipe your butt for you, you know what I mean? Alright, that's it, you done. Almost 3 hours. Take care, okay? It's Charlie, Kapoki, Catamount, like a stepping razor. Out of here.